Welcome, First Christian Church of Pittsburg, on this glorious Lord's Day. So good to be here with you all today. Sorry about the technical difficulty. We will not have a slideshow today because this will be an adapter that allows us to plug the ancient cord out of the ancient projector into the brand new laptop as broken. So we'll get that fixed this week, and we have it running next week. But that just was working. It really was working 20 minutes ago. So, anyways, what else is going on? Anybody have any announcements? Yes, ma'am.
Next Sunday at the second service, so all of the kids from teeny tiny all the way up to seniors in high school, that is to celebrate them moving on. And to celebrate, we're going to have Sundays after the service. But that'll be next Sunday. I do have some youth welcome packets. Our parents meeting is this Wednesday, so if you know of any youth that you think would be someone great to invite to youth group, let me know. We can get them a packet. The back to school bash is September 7th. That's a Wednesday from 5 to 7. There are still brochures out there, so you can invite people to that too. And that might be everything. Thank you.
All right. Any other announcements? Anyone have any prayer concerns? Can you share? I'll pray for the Lord. How about joys? Any joys? Share. Yes, ma'am.
It's Skylar's birthday.
Oh, yeah! Happy birthday, Skylar! Yay! All right.
And she started a new job.
Yes, she has a new job at Parks.
Independence.
Kids. Teaching fourth grade. Yes. So that's very, very cool. Yeah, so let's celebrate. Any other joys? All right. Oh, yes, ma'am.
First Sunday, I asked for prayers online, and she's actually completely better and has no memory of the issue she had before.
Wow.
So that was definitely her answer.
Name, what was her name?
It's a family member.
Oh, family member. Okay.
Oh,
And also, for our visitors, the lyrics to the hymns are generally on the slideshow, so we wouldn't expect everybody to have them memorized. Right, well, please pray with me. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this beautiful sunny Sunday morning. We give you thanks for bringing us all here safely today. And we humbly ask that your Spirit be here with us, Lord, fill each of us. And Lord's Day, we give you thanks for Skylar's birthday and for her new job teaching. And it's such a blessing here at Pittsburg. We pray that she's a blessing at her new school, and that you would bless her and give her peace. We also give you thanks that Diana's family member is healed, and we ask your blessing upon her and her family. Lord, we don't live in a perfect country. We definitely need a lot of help in relating to each other. It seems like, well, most of us get along, but we turn on the news and just see so much discord, Lord. We ask for peace in our nation before it goes beyond just shouting. We ask that you help us to be understanding, to promote peace and love, to find ways to dialogue with those with whom we disagree, and bring about transformation, that we could be one people with all of our differences, but one people in peace with each other. No, just because we might disagree in some ways, it doesn't make us enemies. And also we ask, Lord, that you help all the people of earth accept those who are different from them, not to see them as enemies or as less than, like our Lord Jesus did in his ministry, when he lifted up those who were oppressed and marginalized. Help us to see everyone as your beloved children and encourage others to do the same. And we ask this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture today comes from the Gospel according to Mark chapter 4. Sprout and grow, then the head, then the full brain in the head. But what the brain is like, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come. He also said, what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. The word of the Lord. If only farming were that easy. I mean, the farmer, he's not even planting, he's just scattering seed, just throwing them all over the place. And one day he noticed that he's got a field full of crops ready to harvest. How the heck did that happen? He didn't know. And I know farming, that's not how farming is at all. Much more complex than that. And that's Jesus isn't saying that's what farming is like either. He's saying that that's what the kingdom of God is like. The seed is scattered, and God takes care of the rest. Now please enjoy this installment of It's All Greek to Me. See, the words translated of itself come from the Greek word automatos, from which we get the English word automatically. The man in the parable doesn't lift a finger to ensure a good crop. It just happens automatically. And Jesus is telling us that's how God's kingdom comes. It grows and develops automatically. So God will take care of the hard part. We get the easy part. We get to scatter seed. And the seeds are our words and deeds of faith, proclamation that Jesus Christ is Lord. We scatter seed out there, and God does the work. God's Holy Spirit causes that kingdom seed to grow in those who receive it. The power and eloquence of our witness does not matter. God is the one who grows faith in the fields of humanity. And some seed takes a lot longer to germinate than others. Miss Linda, the wonderful secretary of the church I served down in Canada, Missouri, she gave me a lot of encouragement when I would get frustrated in ministry. A lot of folks would come to that church looking for help for various things. And after a short period of time there, I decided I would share with them, I would take that opportunity to plant some seeds. I would share with them what God had done for me on my journey with them, and then invite them to become part of the church. However, out of the dozens of times I put out that invitation, only one person made it to a worship service. One person. And I share my frustration about this with Miss Linda, and she'd say, well, planted a seed. And I'd say, yeah, I planted a seed. And that was kind of our thing. And she'd say, planted a seed. Yeah, planted a seed. But she was right. She was right. Eventually, I learned through a very reliable grapevine that a couple of families that I had helped went and became part of other churches. So she was right. She was right. They just didn't sprout up where I wanted them to, but it still worked. They're still where they ought to be. So she was right. Just plant the seed and trust God to do the rest. And I know it can be scary to scatter these kinds of seeds, but the fact that God causes them to grow ought to be encouraging to us. Yes, it's not that we ought to be afraid of saying the wrong thing. It's that we ought to say something, anything, to anyone as often as possible, and trust that God will guide what we say as well as cause the seed to grow. Now, moving on to the mustard seed. As one scholar put it, the point, in other words, is not just that the mustard plant starts as a proverbially small seed and grows into a shrub of 3 or 4 feet, or even higher. It is that it tends to take over where it is not wanted, that it tends to get out of control, and that it tends to attract birds within cultivated areas where they are not particularly desired, and that, said Jesus, was what the kingdom of God was like. Not like the mighty cedar of Lebanon, and not quite like a common weed, more like a pungent shrub with dangerous takeover properties, something you would want in only small and carefully controlled doses, if you could control it. Once in a sermon, I complained that a lot of new churches don't look like churches. If it wasn't for the signage, you wouldn't know what the building was. Is it a metal barn? Is it an indoor soccer arena? Is it a Mennonite grocery store? What the heck is that thing? I remember seeing one get built outside of Kent years ago. Wondering, what is that thing? What is that thing? Turned out it was a church. Big rectangular metal building. Plain as could be, it was a church. And I thought, it shouldn't be that way. No, churches should look like churches. But I was wrong. Really, whatever works, works. Just like the humble beginnings of the church. A function over form is what we need. We don't have to have gargoyles and stained glass. That's crazy, isn't it? And churches are springing up everywhere. In strip malls, downtown storefronts, business parks, in the middle of nowhere, all over the place. And that the great big stately high steeple churches, unfortunately, are getting boarded up at an alarming rate. But these humbler, shrub-like churches are popping up all over the place. Now check this out. In another parable, the parable of the sower, which Mark has back at the beginning of chapter 4, birds are shown as undesirable because they eat the seed that fell on the path. And in the parable of the mustard seed, they are shown making nests in the shade of the mustard bush, which is like the kingdom of heaven. So a shrub that can take over a garden gives shade to creatures who are unwelcome in a garden, or gives space to undesirables, a place for undesirables. Which got me wondering, who are our undesirables today? In the Gospels, it seems like the undesirables of Jesus' day were the most desirable to him. Jesus was known for being a friend of tax collectors and sinners and prostitutes. He healed Gentiles. He touched a leper. He consorted with Samaritans. All things upstanding Hebrews would not do back then. And yet Jesus is the Son of God. And he did it. He was surrounded by undesirables. He made a place for undesirables. Now, trying to be as enlightened as possible in the Christian sense, the only people in the whole world I would say are undesirable are people who want to do us harm. But Jesus said, love your enemies. And Jesus and many of the apostles and many other Christians over the millennia died loving their enemies. So who's undesirable? It's really tough. I wish I could embrace all that automatically. I guess I'm not ready for harvest yet. That is a tough thing to wrap your head around, to be open to. And I've been struggling with this lately, struggling with enemies, people I would think of as undesirable, but it looks like I'm not supposed to count anybody out according to Jesus. And I don't mean, like, I don't think these people are a direct threat to me at this moment. But because I'm a straight, white, Christian, cisgender, male citizen of these United States, I was born here. I'm their people. They think people like, guys like me ought to be running everything. However, they will and have harmed people who don't belong to my demographic. They want to put those folks back in their place, back in their part of town, back in their country, back in the closet. They want to turn society's clock back 70 years. Now, my solution was just to give them the state of Texas. They could all go live there and be their own country. And then Mexico will pay for a wall to keep them out of Mexico. I guarantee it. And of course, the U.S. will airlift all the folks out of Austin. We can't leave those folks out there. But the seed of faith planted in me, regardless of how amazing that plan sounds, said, no, that's wrong. You can't do that. We have to work this out together, Lord, I pray. Work it out peacefully. Once again, it's very easy for me to say, because I'm not in their crosshairs yet. But looking at American history, I see it's better to win hearts and minds and promote peace than to put millions of people on a Texas-sized reservation. So I'm praying for peace and love and understanding as often as it crosses my mind these days. I'm spreading those kinds of seeds wherever and whenever I get the opportunity. And I encourage all of you to do the same and trust that God will make them grow. Yes, these parables of Jesus, they make you think. I mean, if you feel like thinking. And they're one of the ways that Jesus scattered seed. And we're all called to do the same. So scatter those seeds. Let them fly. Don't be stingy with them. Don't be afraid. We don't have to be master farmers or gardeners or evangelists. We can't get it wrong because God takes care of the hard part. He makes those seeds grow automatically. Amen. And if you would like to become a member of this growing congregation, we ask that you come forward after our communion hymn.
it was 2000. I was in an adult Sunday school class in my home church in Bonner Springs. And I hadn't, it was the most people I'd ever seen in that class. It was jam-packed, I would say. Maybe a couple dozen people. And we got into this heated debate over salvation. How do you know you're saved? And I didn't get involved. I didn't think so. There was one guy who was really animated about this, and he got up at one point, pointed to the Bible, and he said, I believe what it says in this Bible. I believe what it says in here. I think what started it all is somebody suggested that maybe there's room in the kingdom of heaven for people who aren't necessarily Christians. And a lot, some of the folks were comfortable with that. Some of the folks really weren't. And it went on and on until the Sunday school teacher asked the pastor, well, what do you think? And he said, I'm going to read it because I'll probably not get it right, but he said, now everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom. No, wait, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. That just, it was almost like the room had been filled with a sedating gas. Everybody just kind of mellowed out and shut up for a second. And I don't know if we were all asking ourselves and saying, who's safe then? How do we know? And that was pretty darn brilliant. But that's one of the things I love about the Christian church, Disciples of Christ, is that we can have disagreements like that. People can get all fired up, and yet we're still friends. We're still together. We're still on the same page. We don't have to be in lockstep with each other theologically. We don't have a list of things that they say, you have to believe this to be a member of this church. Just that we want to be here. We want to be here together in peace. One of our early mottos for our denomination was no creed but Christ, because creeds were one of the things that divided up the denominations so long ago and still do today. And our founders, we don't have creeds. We don't have a set of things you have to believe in order to be the church. We have a diversity of beliefs, which is a wonderful thing. Wonderful thing to hear other people's perspectives instead of everyone having to say the same thing or, oh, I'm going to be in trouble if I don't get it right. There are no, well, I wouldn't say there were no wrong answers. there are some. But there's a lot more wiggle room. And that's good. And we can grow together at the pace at which God is causing us to grow, which is wonderful. And no matter what we believe, we can all come together at Jesus' table and eat in peace. Because everyone is welcome. Besides our theological diversity, that's the other thing I know I've told you I love so much about our denomination, is that everyone, we invite everybody to Jesus' table, because Jesus called everybody to himself. And so we follow in his footsteps. We do the same thing. For it was on the night when our Lord was betrayed that he took bread. And when he gave him thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Please pray. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for this great feast. We give you thanks for our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us to set us free from the power of sin and death forever and ever and ever. We ask your blessing upon the bread and the cup. We ask that your Spirit be here with us. We ask that this be a truly, truly deep spiritual experience for everyone here. And we ask this in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Now we have three communion and offering tables here in the fellowship hall, one close right here, and one at both exits. Come to the table.